You are listening to the fourth segment of our eight-part series, Bountiful Beans, with Susan Weed at Time Monk Radio. Hello, Susan. Welcome back to Time Monk Radio.
Hi, Gemini. Did you get to have some peas this week?
I did. I had sugar snap peas.
Ooh, they're so good, aren't they?
They are delicious this time of year, yes.
They're part of the Pick Your Own at our CSA. And I went out with my granddaughter, and we picked a bunch. And after we had picked for a while, she looked and she said, "How did you get so many more than I got?" And before I could answer, she said, "You're not eating them all like I am, are you?"
That's cute.
I showed her how the peas are grown in a really nice system where they put a double row of stakes in the ground and then run twine. Right, and then the peas are planted in between, so they have kind of a support, and sometimes they flop over, they curl around, they got something to grab onto, and so I showed her how to stick her hand in the middle, right, because they plant a thick double row, right, and had to get your hand in there where all the foliage is and feel around for the peas.
Oh, that's good. Now, unfortunately, here our cardinals love our beans just as much as we do.
Oh my gosh!
Yes.
And it's hard to be mad at a cardinal, even if it's stealing your peas or your beans, huh?
Yes, I just wish they'd eat the same one instead of a bite from all of them.
Oh, well, they have to find out which is the best.
That's true.
The connoisseur of cardinals tasting each one of your beans. Does it ruin the bean, or do you get to still eat it?
We just, you know, slice off that part where they've
enjoyed. You know, that's what I say to people. I say, you know, if you're going to grow food, you're going to have to learn to share.
That's right. And we do.
Right, because there's a lot of life out there that wants a bite of your food.
Absolutely.
Well, this week we are going to be looking at lentils. Often when I talk about beans, people get the idea that I just mean like a pot of baked beans. And hey, those are definitely beans, and it's a wonderful way to have them. But as we've been seeing, lima beans are also beans, and peas are also beans, and lentils are also beans, too. Lenient lentil, grant me grace. Give me an iron will. Keep me from hunger. Lentil, lens, protect me from unseen deviations. Support me from above. Allow me to see at a different scale. Lovely lentil, show me how to get through the dry times. Remind me that I am made of the earth. Repair the inevitable mistakes of living. Holy lentil, pulse in me, spiral me into visions. Pave the sacred way to me. The Bean Sisters have many stories to tell. Some are in chorus, and some are solo. Green beans do a duet. Dry beans sing harmony and tell coyote tales. Fenugreek is sweet, but her anecdotes can carry a sting. Soy is accommodating, but rather long-winded. Fava is raucous and rowdy and full-bodied as well. Her stories go on all night. And lentil? Well, lentil is a special friend of mine. Ever since I found out, she carries a DNA repair kit, because I just did. Door tool totem mamas. The chances of harboring a malignant cell are very great for any organism that's exposed to solar radiation, who breathes oxygen and engages in massive cellular replication at all times. In case you haven't guessed, that's us. So we have to have the means to correct replication errors in our DNA. And we do. But we don't always, because there are injuries and genetic glitches in the DNA, and so we need help. And the proteins and phytosterolic constituents in lentils help us do this. In fact, I've noticed that there are now skin care products available that include lentil extracts to repair damage to the skin. Allow me to introduce you to Sister Lentil, also known as Sister Doll. She is short and bushy, and it's true, she produces only 2 seeds per pod. It is the lens-like shape of those seeds, combined with their culinary primacy, that gives her the botanical name Lens culinaris. Evidence of lentil cultivation and consumption goes back about 13,000 years in the Near East. In India, traces of lentil production have been dated back more than 5,000 years, or about 3,500 BCE. The lentils have been found in the Egyptian pyramids and in a Stone Age village in the Swiss Alps. Sister Doll is not quite as various in her colors as the dried bean chorus, but she is far from monochrome and can be found in green, yellow, orange, black, brown, and speckled skins. As a North American, you're probably most familiar with her large green forms, such as Estin, Richelieu, and Laird, which are sold with their skins intact. That's what to most of us is. Lentils are, as one person put it, hippie lentils. Is that what you're talking about? It's true, you get a lot of nutrition for very little money with lentils. But the rest of the world is actually more likely to be enjoying lentils that are yellow, such as macachiatos, brown masoors, orange or black beluga lentils, and both with and without their skins. In fact, one of my favorite lentils is a skinless red-orange lentil. It has such a super short cooking time. I take 3 cups of water, bring it to a boil, and pour 1 cup of dried red-orange lentils into it. It cooks to a tasty mush in just under 20 minutes, and you can season it, you can eat it hot, you can eat it cold. You know, it's just good. My second favorite lentils are those tiny, chewy French depew lentils. They can sometimes be speckled black or gray or kind of blue-green. Unlike the orange lentils, which are always sold without their skin and so get mushy when they cook, the French lentils, also called caviar lentils, are always sold with their skins on, and so they hold their shape when they are cooked. And they are really small lentils, and so they combine very, very well with a host of other things. I make a potato salad with roasted potatoes and these little caviar lentils, and it is really a potato salad that wants to be at the Ritz, not out on a picnic. The little French lentils have a particularly rich and satisfying taste. It's true that Sister Lentil is short in stature, but she's not short on nourishment. In fact, lentils are considered one of the 5 most nutritious foods on the planet. A cup of lentils gives us 18 grams of protein, 16 grams of fiber, 24 grams of carbohydrate, and all those minerals, B vitamins, and, of course, folic acid. 30% of what we're eating when we eat lentils is protein. In fact, they have the 3rd highest amount of protein of any seed following soy and hemp. 50 grams of cooked lentils. That is not very much. We're talking like 2 ounces of cooked lentils here contain as much protein as 67 grams of beef, including excellent amount of the essential amino acids isoleucine, tryptophan, and lysine. I'm sure you have heard of the last 2 because they're used in a variety of ways taken in pill form. It all sounds good, doesn't it? It does indeed. And lentils are good, but lentils are missing two vital amino acids, methionine and cysteine. And so in order for lentils to be complete protein, they need to be combined with a grain, a green, meat, or dairy. Any choice, column A, column B, or column C, works just fine. So we could have lentils with rice or lentils with corn, and that would take care of the two amino acids that we need. Or we could mix lentils together with a green, such as amaranth or spinach or kale. And again, those will provide the needed amino acids that are missing, or small amounts of meat or dairy products which do contain the complete suite of amino acids that are needed for human nutrition, thus helping us to use the amino acids that are in the lentils. In fact, lentils and rice is a staple dish around the world. And it's called all different kinds of names. It's eaten in Asia, it's eaten in India and Pakistan. The Egyptians is a national dish, rice and lentils. In Europe, in North and South America, lentils are not so often combined with rice. They're more often combined with vegetables or with meat. And, of course, that hippie lentil soup is truly a nourishing meal. 1 cup of cooked lentil soup supplies about 52% of our daily need for fiber. Unless, of course, you're using skinless lentils like the orange ones. Another way to complete the essential amino acid group in lentils is to sprout them. Soaking lentils overnight helps to eliminate the anti-nutritional factors that are found in all seeds. We're not saying that lentils alone have some kind of anti-nutritional factors. We're saying that lentils, like all seeds, contain trypsin inhibitors, phytates. They are, it's true, especially abundant in lentils, but virtually every seed known, and that includes all whole grains, all edible seeds, all nuts, and of course all of the beans, do contain these anti-nutritional qualities, which literally latch onto, chelate onto needed nutrients in our bodies. One of the most pernicious of these is that these anti-nutritional substances latch onto vitamin B12 and take it out of circulation and make it unavailable to you. And this is a big problem for people who are following a vegan or vegetarian diet, because these diets are generally quite lacking in vitamin B12 or insufficient amounts of vitamin B12. So it is somewhat of a twist of fate that the protein powders made from peas, the protein powders made from soybeans, act in this way to actually, because they are not cooked, but are raw powders, they actually interfere with our body's ability to utilize vitamin B12, which is so critical for our health. So we will leave those aside and remember that all of these anti-nutritional substances are eliminated both by sprouting and by soaking. Often people remember to soak their beans overnight, but don't prepare their lentils in this way. It's quite important with your lentils. In fact, it's quite important with all of your grains. And I sometimes don't know what to say to people who eat muesli, who eat raw oatmeal, because, again, we have the problem with these anti-nutritional substances. Lentils, like all other beans, are rich in purines, which are naturally occurring substances found in both plants and animals. And they actually literally break down into uric acid. And too much uric acid in the blood, which we get from eating foods high in purines, is both a cause and an antagonizer of gout and kidney stones. As we said before, medical thought has for thousands of years believed that all purine-rich foods are to blame, but modern studies are suggesting that the purines in plants are much less harmful than the ones found in meat and fish. And the starches in lentils, the carbohydrates in lentils, are very slowly digested, giving lentils a pretty low glycemic load, 6 out of 100 for half a cup, and a very low glycemic index. And your glycemic load should be low. The glycemic index number should be high. Cooked lentils are 30 and canned lentils are 52. Lentils, like all beans, contain a mix of carbohydrates, including readily digestible starch, slowly digested starch, and resistant starch. Remember back to the first that we were talking about. We were talking about soluble fibers and insoluble fibers. And these starches that we're talking about are actually part of those starches. The resistant starch is not digested in the small intestine. Amylose is one-third of that resistant starch in lentils, providing food for the health-promoting bacteria that live in the large intestine. Some studies find that most, but not all, people have improved insulin sensitivity and improved absorption of minerals when they eat foods rich in non-soluble fiber, like beans. A cup of cooked lentils supplies 120% of the recommended daily amount of folate, natural form of folic acid, 76% of the RDA of vitamin B1, that's thiamine, 42% of both pantothenic acid, B5, and vitamin B6, 18% of riboflavin, that's B2, 17% of B3, that's niacin, 198% of our daily need of molybdenum, and remember that helps us process sulfites, 64% of the recommended daily amount of phosphorus, 58% of iron, 50% of zinc, 50% of manganese, 34% of magnesium, 25% of copper, 20% of potassium, 6% of calcium, and even 5% of the vitamin C that we need on a daily basis. Wow! Lentils are wonderful. Oh, they're even more wonderful than you thought. Lentils are pretty tolerant to drought, which makes them a very sustainable crop, even on marginal land. About 4 million metric tons of lentils are grown yearly worldwide. And the leading grower and largest exporter of lentils is Canada. India grows only a quarter of all cultivated lentils, although they eat more lentils than any other place in the world. In the U.S., lentils are primarily grown in eastern Washington and Idaho, not in the coastal areas, but there in those desert areas. Sister Lentil is holy, may I tell you. She has been blessed by the 70 prophets, praises be. She's been blessed by both Jesus and Mohammed. All right, they agree on something, that Sister Lentil is blessed. In the Bible, Esau gives up his birthright to Jacob in exchange for a dish of lentils. When you're hungry, what can we say? Lentils symbolize rebirth and hope. They look like coins, so they're traditionally eaten on New Year's Eve or New Year's Day for prosperity. Where I grew up in Texas, eating black-eyed peas on New Year's Day brought luck all year. The lentils are associated with mourning in some Jewish traditions, and women in southern India have a spiritual practice in which sprouted or soaked lentils are the sacred offering to Lakshmi, goddess of abundance. In the original Grimm's fairy tale, Cinderella's stepmother makes her sort lentils from the ashes. That is, she must distinguish between that which nourishes life, lentils, and that which we become at death, ashes. Ashes, ashes, we all fall down, interrupt the Bean Sisters in a sing-song chant. Now that we have your attention, we wish to tell you a story. Sit down here and help us sort the small rocks and organic debris out of these lentils that we wish to cook, and we will spin a tale for you. We will. We will. When the world was young and life was new, there was no eyes. Life felt pressure, temperature, movement, taste, and smell, and in this way, life saw all there was to see without needing eyes. Light there was, and life felt its warmth, but there were no eyes to see the light. Dark there was, and life felt its cooling relief, but there were no eyes to peer through the gloom or to pierce the shadows. Life was itself. Life felt all the ways that it was. Life always felt like itself. Life was entire unto itself, and there was no need to see anything other. All was all, and all was as it was. One must keep an eye on the other, the Bean Sisters whisper to each other and to us. Keep an eye out, we do. What is other bears watching, look out, we do. All was as it was, yet life desired to look at itself, and life wanted to see the other, and change was. Life curved away from unity, and life curved into itself. And a lens looked out from the middle of it all. The lens saw all, for it came from all. The lens saw unity, for it was made from one. The lens saw the other, for it arose from separation. Life discovered itself. It was one, and it was other. The lens saw itself and knew it was part of a larger life, was part of the face of that life, was the eye of the face. The lens experimented with pushing itself to the front of the face. There, the eye became the vanguard. There, in front of it all, the lens could get a jump on the other. It could be prepared by looking ahead. It could look down its nose at the other, and it could stare into the eyes of the other. The lens experimented with pushing itself to the opposite sides of the face. It wanted to take a good look around. It wanted to see over its own shoulder. It wanted to be eyes in the back of the head. It wanted to see if anything was gaining on it. The lens could see near. The lens could see far. The lens could see deep and high. Some others were near. Some others were far. The eye can see more than movement. The eye can see more than pattern. The eye can see the other in detail, can see the near other and the far other. The far away other is further away from self, less like self, less detailed, and thus more different. The nearer other is closer, closer to self, definition, distinction, division. What was one has become two, and this creates distance, depths, breadth, height, and lets loose the arrow of time. What had existed timelessly in a creamy, pearlescent ether now looked forward, moved forward, saw the light, kept its eyes open, kept its eyes on the quarry. Without the lens, no time, no duality, no other. With the lens, the eye and the other, fear, anxiety, fight, flight. The lens is one, but made of two. It sees other as well as seeing itself. Are you looking? Close your eyes. Let go of your eyes. Return, if only for a breath, to all. We do. We all do. Here is the lens, the Bean Sisters chortle, pointing with their chins. She is the one who started all this trouble with death and duality. Her right there, Sister Lentil. Okay, she makes up for it by being a healer, by helping life as it cycles between birth and death, between self and other, and we honor her, we do. And yes, we forgive her, we do, and we tell her story, we do. We hope you will eat her and remember the wholeness of which you were made. That's what's important to us. Will you do it? Will you? All right. And then you can go. But come back, for we want to tell you more about beans. We have other stories. We have sweet stories. We have stick-to-your-rib stories. We have deep stories and bright stories and beanie stories and medicine wheel of plant use stories. Oh, do come back. Come back, do. Aristophanes said, "You who dare insult lentil soup, the sweetest of all delicacies?" Pliny did not reply to him. Pliny said to others, "For an even temper, eat lentils." And Hippocrates, the so-called father of medicine, said, "Lentils heal liver ailments." Okay, lentils, in fact, are considered an antiseptic, a cardioprotective, a diuretic, a nerving, an anti-cholesterol, and a stress-proofer. Not only that, lentils contain protease inhibitors. I think of all the things about lentils, the one that strikes me the most is that lentils contain a toolkit which allows them to go into the nucleus of any cell in your body to look at the DNA there, and if there's a genetic glitch or if there's a problem that's occurred in the DNA, lentils with the her repair kit repairs that stretch of DNA and makes it fully functional. I don't know of any other thing that does that. Certainly all plants in the bean family, true beans, not things like coffee beans, really give us enormous health benefits. But only lentils and red clover, so far as I know, actually carry this repair kit that gives us so much hope that even if a cancer has been found and has been diagnosed, that it might very well be possible to reverse that diagnosis. I was surprised to find that lentils and all beans, as a matter of fact, are very high in iron. You know, women are often low in iron. And so I get asked frequently, "Oh, what should I do? My iron level is so low." And I have favorite things that I have them do. I have them drink nettle infusion or perhaps take a tincture of yellow dock. Certainly eat more yogurt is a very important thing as well. But lentils just come up and bring up the iron level. Iron supplements are actually somewhat poisonous, and more doctors are backing away from using iron supplements and using foods and other ways to get that iron in our diet. So isn't that a thrill that eating our beans and eating our lentils is another great way to impact the iron? Who needs more iron? Growing children need more iron. Lactating women need more iron. Pregnant women need more iron. Women who flood at all during menstruation need more iron. Menopausal women need more iron. So I guess we could very safely say most women is who needs more iron. Without the lens, there is no time and no duality. The lens is one. It sees other as well as seeing self. Close your eyes and return to the all. Here is Sister Lentil. We tell her story, and we hope you will eat her and remember the wholeness of which you were made. Yes, come back again, and we will tell you more bean stories. And it's true. I will be right back next week. with more adventures in Bountiful Beans for you. We are still to look at soybeans, chickpeas, fava beans, astragalus, red clover, fenugreek, peanuts, Anasazi beans, crazy beans. We still have a lot of territory to cover. I'm sure you'll be here where all the green blessings are. And in between, go over to SusanWeed.com. That's SusanWeed, SusanWeed.com. Or navigate over to WiseWomanBookshop.com. You'll find lots of interesting things in both places. Thank you so much for having me on this show, Gemini.
Thank you, Susan.
And good night, everyone. Thank you for remembering that food is your best medicine. And thank you for remembering that herbal medicine is people's medicine. It's the medicine right outside your door. Until next week, green blessings.
This completes the fourth segment of our 8-part series, Bountiful Beans with Susan Weed at Time Monk Radio.